Well, welcome to day 10 and a snow edition of the Mandatory Quarantine Show. We're into the double digits finally. Yay! Double digits. So, with only a little bit of time left, of course, the weather decides that, okay, you know, let's show you what Canada's really like at the time. So we right now have a bit of, I guess it's kind of like sleety, freezing rain sort of snow coming down today. And so I thought I better do the video before tonight. There's supposed to be a larger storm, so maybe tomorrow we'll have some little bits lifting up off the chair if I come out here. I was debating whether I wanted to even do it inside today, but I thought, no, we're gonna do it in the gazebo again. So topic for today, we're, you know, nearing the end. Still no symptoms, nothing to report. You know, I really kind of enjoyed that whole documentary talk yesterday, and there was one bit of that documentary that I didn't kind of delve into. And that was, they used to do, inside of at least the city of London, something that they called the Bill of Mortality. And it was basically a listing of all the deaths that had happened within London and the causation as far as they could tell for the death. So, you know, you would get stuff there of, you know, asphyxiation or poisonings or, you know, old age or whatever, and they would be listed out day by day. And today, one of the things that they would really watch for was actually plague was one of those things, and they would hope that a number stayed at zero. And today, I think we're all looking at our own bills of mortality, and rather than buying it from a penny off the shopkeep, we're constantly clicking the refresh on the numbers that are going on. Tracking of those numbers in that era was based upon local health departments putting in those numbers. And of course, if there's nobody to put in the number or they don't know what it is, they said different things. And there was also a policy in some of those places where you didn't really want to say that your village was being hit by plague, because then people wouldn't come and go to your shops, or you'd have to have lock-ins and all sorts of stuff like that. And today we're seeing that even with some of the COVID numbers. You know, a lot of people say, well, oh, they're doing that, they're inflating the numbers or deflating the numbers, or there's actions there. And there's some of that, but also some of it is just miseducation or non-education on the part of the healthcare profession in diagnosing or treating this or being unable to get those numbers. So I think it kind of bridges into the whole idea of kind of denialism of what the situation is, that people are saying, oh, well, they've inflated it for some reason, or they've deflated it on purpose. I think some of it is probably just genuine. We didn't have time to report or put it into the numbers, or we didn't think it was. Some of it might just be a doctor not wanting to report because they don't want a certain area. And especially when you put this into the placement of individual cities or units reporting their own numbers, that they want to look good to the higher up government around them. You see these issues, especially right now when I was in Russia. I know that there's cases that were not being put onto the official tallies, and I don't think that was anyone, you know, purposefully sitting there and going, I'm going to fake the numbers. I think that part of that was just, you know, misunderstanding of what are those numbers even for. Or maybe they are doing it because they don't want their local area to go down into some form of higher level lockdown than that. But the better that your data is, the better that you can actually then put responses in it. So it's kind of a self-defeating action for people to lie about what's happening. You know, I think this is something where we can't really blame any individual set for the causation of the whole big pandemic. I think that there's a lot of individual responsibility in protecting yourself and your loved ones and those around you. But I would say that it's definitely not at the hands of, you know, the local doctor as to how many cases of this occur in their area, unless they're like purposefully telling people not to put on, you know, and follow various protocols. So this is the problem, is people take the blame who shouldn't have it, people take the responsibility who shouldn't have it, and really it's a distributed issue of who has the role and responsibilities to do that. At the end of the day, as I said, early on to this, right? I'm sitting here, I've been inside of the same house for now 10 days. I haven't been out doing anything. My wife hasn't been out doing anything. We're following the things. We're phoning the government. You know, if they phone, then we try to respond to that. We're doing everything that we're supposed to do. So there's that personal responsibility in it, that we're trying to protect those around us. But if people don't have that, and, you know, hey, you want to have a big giant party, hey, you want to have the, you know, the friends or you know, it's just one little event that has this many people. Well, what happens is when you say that and they say that and that, it leads into something known as game theory as the free rider problem. And it's also known as the tragedy of the commons. So we can see this as, okay, well, if I don't follow the rules, you know, it's you in and of yourself is not a problem. So the free rider problem, you have a subway. And in the subway, there's a ticket booth, and the turnstiles are not really well monitored. For those of you maybe who have been to, like, in Denmark, you can just hop on a train. You know, you don't have to have a ticket, you just hop on a train. If they catch you, there's a huge giant fine. But there's nothing really stopping you from hopping on a train or hopping the turnstiles in the subway. And maybe some people look at you and go, oh, that guy's a jerk. But really, there's nothing forcing you to pay for it. So what do you do? On the individual basis, if you wanted to save money, you'd say, well, I'm just going to not follow the thing. There's no enforcement. Nobody's going to stop me, and I'm not going to do it. But what happens is when a sufficient number of people don't follow that, when a sufficient number of people don't follow that, the whole subway system shuts down because it doesn't make enough income to cover the ridership. So we're able to have a certain amount of free riders. We're able to have a certain amount of people that go, you know what, that restriction doesn't apply to me. But every time that someone does that, there's a huge risk that we flip the dice and the whole system shuts down. And we're calling that basically a lockdown. So that's my thoughts on this, is it really is a free rider problem. And there's a few ways to get rid of the free rider, mostly through enforcement. And also part of it is just, let's just accept that, you know, this problem exists and try to work around it. Well, that's my thoughts on day 10, and I will see you all on day 11. Bye.